All right, the recording has started. Okay, bir de hocam the stage. Thank you.
Okay, just a sec. Let me arrange. Well, there are multiple things here. So today I will talk about quantum field theory, a very interesting quantum field theoretic system, a three-dimensional model. It is a, and I will describe it in some parts in fairly elementary terms. It will be, I think every person will find something in this story for themselves, okay? And it looks like some, you know, it is some gauge theory in three dimensions. It is a gauge field. This is non-Abelian gauge field. It is an, this system has an some underlying S2N symmetry, okay? It is a non-Abelian gauge field. You can write this as an N by N traceless matrix, okay, N by N matrix. It is a scalar, which is also an N by N matrix. These N by N matrices are traceless. So trace of this thing is actually whatever the field you put is zero.
So I think while you're holding the tablet, you are kind of pressing against the...
Oh, yeah, I did. I realized. Okay, thank you very much. No so, problem. Is it okay now?
Yes, it is.
Okay. So, trace is zero. So, there is n squared minus one. For example, here, gluons. And there are also n squared minus one scalars in the game. Let me tell you why I will be telling you about this model. This is something called Polyakov model, you know, solved at leading order in semiclassics by Polyakov around 74, 75, okay? And it is a, it's a very interesting toy model for some, to understand some properties of the four-dimensional gauge theories. So let me tell you why we will be interested in this theory. One of them is, okay, and we will view this as a toy model for Yang-Mills. At least we will be able to understand some properties of the Yang-Mills theory very precisely. And we can, at the end, I will also tell you about something about Yang-Mills, but there are two reasons that, there are two things that we would like to understand in Yang-Mills theory that are fairly important and also non-perturbative. So one of them is actually something you know very well. All of you know that in Newton's equation, in classical mechanics, there's a concept of mass. Mass, you can view it mass as, in some sense, you exert a force to some entity, and its resistance to accelerate, okay, is called its mass. If it is light, it will accelerate quickly. If it is heavy, it will not accelerate. You can hardly move it. You know, it will accelerate tiny little bits. And you differentiate these two objects by their mass. So in classical mechanics, actually mass is an intrinsic quantity that we associate with bodies. You know, if you are given a body in classical mechanics, we say it has this mass, you know, let me say intrinsic property. Intrinsic property. Okay. We do not question it. We do not question why it is there. What do I mean by this? So if you think, if you think about, all of us have masses, all the things that that surrounds us, all the material objects have masses, okay? So I just want to tell you something interesting about it. Actually, so if you think our bodies, and if you consider the number of, so all of our, for example, let's think our body mass. Body mass. All of our masses are coming from the atoms in our body. Okay, we can go to that level of fine tuning. So all of the masses are coming from microscopically from atoms. And in atoms, we have nuclei and electrons. And most of the masses of atoms are in actually nuclei to a great, great extent. And nuclei is actually something also composite. It's composed of protons and neutrons, okay? So if you look to mass of the proton, it is approximately equal to mass of the neutron, okay? And if you look the ratio of this to the electron mass, this is roughly 2000. So you can assume that almost all of your body mass is actually coming from these protons and neutrons. You can actually be ignorant of the electron mass, okay? Now, furthermore, in proton and neutron, we usually say that, so these are composites of quarks and gluons. They are the bound states of quarks and gluons in this theory. My quark or gluon are in these a mu and phi is, you know, gauge field and scalar. And in Yang-Mills theory, pure Yang-Mills theory, it's in only in the gauge part, okay? In QCD, it is just only in, it's composed of quark and gluons. But if you look to, for example, take proton, the quantum numbers matches, you know, two up quark and one down quark. So charges, two-thirds, you know, electric charges are two-thirds, two-thirds, minus one-third. But actually, there is something interesting. If you look to up quark mass or down quark mass, first, let me just remind you something. M proton was similar to 1000 MeV. Okay. M electron was 0.5 MeV approximately. So the ratio I said is like 2000. But if you look to down quark mass, they are also fairly small, actually. It is like few MeV. Okay. So it is as if these constituents inside the proton are massless. So if you go ahead to the underlying theory, for example, to pure Yang-Mills theory or QCD, let's take up quark and down quark mass are so small. It is a fairly good approximation to call them massless to begin with. So in this massless QCD, massless fermions, for example, massless quarks, let me say, okay. This theory and this theory has no dimensionful full mass parameter. So there is no underlying mass concept in the Yang-Mills Lagrangian, okay? But on the other hand, if you calculate in the Yang-Mills theory, if you calculate the first massive excitation, so there is, let's say there is some vacuum here, and if you excite a particle, the first particle you can excite has a mass am global. This is the counterpart of proton in Pyongyang Mills theory is called global. And global is like 1000 MeV. So all I mean to say is that in the microscopic level in nature, for the you can be ignorant of these up and down quark masses. So they really provide like few percent of, to begin with, of your body masses, okay? The rest of your body masses is coming from something, from a concept, which is not a mass, okay? Which is coming from an underlying theory, which does not have a mass parameter in it. You can call this an emergent concept, okay? Emergent concept. So,
could I ask a question here?
Sure.
You defined the global, I mean, not defined, but you said that global is the counterpart of the proton in the Pyongyang-Mills theory.
Morally speaking, it's the first massive excitation.
But it's not the same thing, right?
Of course, it's not the same thing. So in the vacuum, if you create the first massive particles, it is the global in Yang-Mills theory. It has a mass like of this order, which is similar to proton mass. Of course, the quantum numbers, global does not have an electric charge. Proton has an electric charge. All I mean is that in QCD, let's assume you take one flavor QCD. Okay, you have pions and you have baryons, the neutrons and protons. So these pions are, and the combination of these pions and neutrons and protons are the bases, are the fundamental fields entering to the, for example, nuclear physics, okay? But proton, you can, in this idealistic limit, you can think of pion as massless. In nature, pions are relatively light, like 100 MeV, okay? But in certain sense, the first massive excitation in this QCD, if you consider a vacuum of QCD, okay, the first interesting massive excitation is either proton or neutron. Indeed, this is the analogy that I was trying to establish.
Thank you, I understand.
Oh, sure. Of course, you know, as I said, there is also up quark and down quark mass. And I said, it is like 2-3, or let me be generous, 5-10 MeV. But let's, even if you assume it is 10 MeV, it is like 1 in 100. So what I am telling you is that 99% of your body mass, or the mass of this computer and the mass of this room and the mass of the earth and the mass of the all visible universe, morally speaking, is coming from a quantum field theory which doesn't have an intrinsic mass parameter in it. This is the sense that we say many QFTs which do not have any mass parameter can induce mass dynamically mass concept. I find this quite fascinating. So, and this is not, I should also say the following. For example, in this story, there is a negligible part of the mass. Up quark, down quark, and electron. The masses of these fundamental particles are coming from Higgs fields, you know, which is, you know, Higgs particle discovered fairly recently, Higgs fields. And so Higgs fields, okay. So, and Higgs field is, in certain sense, is responsible for a few percent of mass invisible universe. Visible universe are the stuff like us. You know, things composed of, quarks and gluons and light, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. So the rest, you know, like 99, let's say maybe 98% of mass is an emergent concept. Emergent concept. Okay. So this is interesting. I am telling you that at the underlying theory in the gluons, there is no way of writing a mass term, yet in the universe we observe, there's a mass term, okay? This question is called mass gap problem. Mass gap problem. It is one of the, I hope I phrased it in a fairly simple term. So I am literally saying that the mass gap problem in Yang-Mills theory is actually your body mass, okay? And this is very famous problem both in maths and physics, but it is very hard. It is so hard that I would think that, you know, most people gave up thinking about it, most serious people gave up thinking about it, thinking that it is hopeless, okay? Let me tell you another variant of this mass gap problem. Let me phrase it a little bit differently. For example, in QED, there is a mu gauge field, which is photon, which when quantized gives us photon, and photons travel at speed of light. Why? Because they classically satisfy Maxwell's equations, okay? Mr. Maxwell's equations, and their wave solutions which propagate at the speed of light. And this is the reason that we know what light is as a, you know, internally, you know, from our, even before coming to this world, you know, when we are in our mother's womb, if our eyes sufficiently form enough, but maybe it may take time. But we are familiar with lights. And for example, these wave phenomena, we teach it in our, you know, high school, but in QCD or Yang-Mills, there is also a gauge field, which is not M by N matrix, this was M by N matrix. If you write down classical equations of motion, we see that these are now nonlinear, but there are wave solutions, which travel at speed of light. But in high school, we do not learn about gluon waves. Because when you move from classical theory to quantum theory, okay, the a mu of photon remain gapless, remain massless, and a mu associated with gluon actually, roughly speaking, becomes massive, and it forms something called glueball. We can see this glueball, okay? So this is the reason we do not teach this second kind of wave in our in the high school because we do not have a macroscopic interactions with it. The fact that it becomes massive, and the mass is of order of 1,000 MeV tells us that these waves, even if we have to think about them, they are absurdly short range. They are, you know, they decay at a distance scale even smaller than roughly proton size. Okay, this is the second statement of the mass gap problem, that the fact that we do not observe classical waves associated with gluons when we go to quantum theory, because the quantum theory becomes gapped, and then it cannot travel at the speed of light. And this is unlike photon. You go to classical theory or quantum field theory, it doesn't matter, photon is gapless. Okay, this is the second statement of the mass gap problem. And I want to tell you one more thing. Again, this is also something fairly pedagogical. It is something called confinement. So for example, if you take two charges, let's say space is R3, one, so there is time, but we are constraining space on R3, two charges, electric charges, E plus and E minus. The potential between them, all of us knows, is like E square. It can be E plus, E minus, or E minus, E minus, two charges like that. E squared divided by R. So let me take E minus, it doesn't matter, E plus minus, electron-electron or positron-electron. They will either attract or repel by 1/R interaction, Coulomb's interaction. So the interaction potential is something like this. So for example, we love to solve hydrogen atom in this potential. This is V of R. This is in QED. If you go to Young-Neels theory, there is this following very interesting phenomenon. If you take a quark, an anti-quark, and they have so they have non-abelian charges, but you can think of that similar to electric charge, some generalization of the electric charge. If you look to the interaction between them at short distances, the interaction is like G square. G is the counterpart of the electric charge. It is the coupling, G square divided by R at short distances. If you try to pull these two things apart, Q is here and Q bar is here, distance R, you learn that the potential actually grows linearly, sigma times R, okay? So if you look to the potential between a quark and anti-quark, it starts its life as if it is a nice Coulombic field with 1/R interaction, okay? And it starts its life like that, but then something interesting happens. Then something interesting is it just grows. Let me undo that. Undo. Let me use this. So it starts as 1/R, then roughly speaking, B of R has 1/R part and sigma R. So it takes, if you want to separate a quark from anti-quark, it will take infinite energy to separate them because the potential between them is growing linearly, okay? And you cannot separate them in real world. In the real world, the story is a little bit more complicated, but it's not important for us. In Young-Neels theory, if you do simulations, this is the result. So this is again something fairly easy to express. And it tells you that the potential goes from Coulomb potential, Coulombic potential, to some linear potential in separation. And this phenomena is called confinement. And it is one of the fundamental properties of Yang-Mills theory as well as QCD. So two very important problems in Yang-Mills theory and QCD are tied up with this mass gap problem and confinement problem. Any questions?
Sir, may I ask you a question?
Of course.
The term linear to R. It is clear when it is linear, when you increase the distance, the force increases and it takes it back. So is there any reason, other reason that it is linear, for example, why it is not a square type?
So we know it is linear because if we try to calculate this potential, so we calculate it. It will be slight technical answer, but we calculate it by calculating expectation value of the Wilson loop, and it obeys the area law. That's the same statement as linear. Actually, I will answer this question in Polyakov model. This is very interesting question. Why it is not quadratic? Why it is not growing quadratic in R, but just linear in R? I promise you, Habib, I will answer this question in the context of Polyakov model. This is actually a very good question, because in Polyakov model, the naive thing, actually the naive version of the energy associated with some quark anti-quark pair is actually R square. But it turns out that energetically, if you form a flux tube where you have some constant tension, in some sense, constant force, that's a lower energy configuration. It's a dynamics reason, really. Yes. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Sure. Now, let me go after this introduction. These are two physical problems. And interestingly, we can express it at a level of freshman physics. I am pretty sure that there is nothing here in the statement of the problem beyond the level of freshman, okay? So you should at least understand this part. Two things. One, mass is an emergent concept. In the underlying theory, Yang-Mills or QCD, there is nothing like a proton mass, you know, that is intrinsically there. It comes from the theory, but it comes from some interesting mechanism. Two, you do not see quarks or things like quarks and gluons in isolation. You know, they have a very short range, despite the fact that to begin with, quarks and gluons classically are infinite range fields. They are like electrons and photons or whatever it's worth. We see electrons and photons all the time around us. You know, their effect all the time around us and their charge. By C, I mean, for example, when you touch something which has some electric charge, you get the sensation that there is an electric field there and it hits you. But we do not see anything related to quarks. Okay, so, and these quarks are confined to these hadrons and gluons and whatnot, okay? Now, let me, as I said, this is a fairly difficult problem, and there are actually very few QFTs in which these two problems can be solved. By can be solved, I mean, within the standard of theoretical physics, it may not be sufficiently satisfactory for a mathematician, but within the, again, fairly good standards of theoretical physics, we can we assume that they are solved, and they are fairly rigorous solutions, honestly.
Could I ask a question about the previous part before you move on?
Yeah, very good. Yeah.
What is the problem here exactly? I don't see that.
Or maybe the problem is, okay, the problem for the confinement, the problem is why you do not see, you know, isolated quarks, one of it. So, you know, I told you that the potential changes from its short coupling from a Coulombic potential, but this part of the story at long distances, you can measure this on the lattice. It tells you that to separate them takes infinite energy. And the question is really to show these parts. Why does it arise theoretically? If you put this theory on a computer and simulate it, you see this thing. There is this scale, which is like, you see that between a quark and anti-quark, if you try to separate them, instead of, look, here, Gauss's law tells us that, you know, the field starting from here goes around like that, and let's say Q and Q bar, and it enters to there, right? This thing enters to here. So the field goes out symmetrically, but at long distances, if you are looking to this at, from large distances, the field actually may start out symmetrically at very short distances, but then they form a flux tube. And all of the counterparts of the, let's say, this is a charge, this is an anti-charge, okay? It is as if all of the electric field, chromoelectric field that you generate here squeezes into a tiny flux tube, okay? And this thing causes linear confinement. The question is, to derive this confinement. The other question is much easier. The question is to you, why do you have a mass? That is the question, okay? Why an object that you see around you has a mass? Because in the underlying microscopic theory, there is no mass parameter.
We know that Higgs field provided or emerged.
Which one?
Higgs field.
No, I explained. Higgs field only provides 1% of the mass. Higgs field. You know, Higgs is giving mass to electron, up quark, down quark, etc. This is 0.5 MeV. Up and down quark are between 5 and 10 MeVs. Let's say at most 10 MeV, okay? So up, down is, let's say at most 30 MeV. Proton mass and neutron masses are 1,000. MeV, 934 to be precise. So the ratio of proton mass, this is the question actually, to ratio of up, down, and this is coming from Higgs, is like 1/1 Okay. This is one of the most sophisticated PR relations of the high energy physics community with the rest of the community society. They should not say it like this. Everybody thinks that mass is coming from Higgs. No, mass of fundamental particles, which we call quarks, electrons, etc., comes from the Higgs field. And it is a tiny, minuscule part of our masses. Most of our masses, which comes from in our body, which comes from protons and neutrons, they are actually non-perturbative in origin. They are coming from the theory of QCD. This should be very clear to everybody. If you get something from this class, this should be it, okay? So this part is generated by the Higgs. This part, well, there is QCD contribution and there is a negligible Higgs contribution, okay? Higgs to the total is 3%. So 97% of this mass is actually coming from strong dynamics, from a theory which does not have a mass parameter in it. Is that okay?
It's okay for me. So we don't have any mass parameter in QCD. I know that there are parameters which theory doesn't give us naturally. Do we put the mass parameter into the theory ourselves?
No.
Is it something like that?
This is actually no. But not by any means. Actually, theoretically, it is extremely difficult. I didn't say this thing, but there are these mathematics problems. You know, this is really, you cannot put by hand. Gauge invariance forbids you to put a mass term for gluons or quarks of that order magnitude. You can put it for a quark, but not for gluon. But for quark, it would be a model. It would not be real QCD. Microscopic quark mass is something tiny, so tiny that it is negligible. The problem is exactly this. You cannot put a mass to the Lagrangian or to the Hamiltonian, okay, by your hand. That is forbidden. So you have an underlying theory. Let's be, let's make it ideal so that we can sharpen the concept. You have an underlying theory which does not have any mass parameter in it. There is only a dimensionless coupling, which tells you how quarks and gluons couple to each other and how gluons and gluons couple to each other. That's it. And you do not have any more mass parameter than that. So the concept is something emerging. So it is similar in a moral sense. It is similar to the following question. If you think rocks and stones around you or atoms, they do not have life. But on the other hand, if you think a virus or a bacteria or you and me who are talking here, we have a life. We are composed of things which do not have, which do not intrinsically have biology or life or, you know, this ability to communicate with each other in this way.
So we need a possibly new Lagrangian then.
Say that again?
We need a new Lagrangian, possibly. Maybe.
Actually, no, Lagrangian is correct. This is part of the puzzle. If you put this theory, for example, Young-Mills theory, on a computer, make the space and time to a very large grid, okay? Then you look to, for example, how this theory behaves. Theory generates a mass dynamically. This is coming from the vacuum, very non-trivial vacuum structure of the theory. So this is really the puzzle. This is really the question. I hope this is clear to other friends as well. Okay. So how does the theory does it? And again, as I said, there are these millennium problem in mathematics, and this is the mass gap problem is one of them. It's probably one of these difficult ones, most difficult ones, okay? But that is a theoretical challenge both for mathematicians and physicists. But now the interesting thing is there are very few quantum field theories, not Young-Mills or QCD on R4, but some slightly different theories on, for example, on R3, there is Polyakov model, which has similarity to the Yang-Neel theory. It has a gauge field, but it also has a scalar. So it has gauge field, scalar. On R4, there is a theory called Seiberg-Witten. Again, this has gauge field, scalar, and two types of fermions, lambda one, lambda two, in which, and there are two other things. One of them is QCD with, this is on, there is QCD on R3 cross S1, QCD with multiple adjoint fermions, which only gauge fields and lambda, these are fermions. Let me call them psi. Psi is a more canonical name for fermion. Psi, one, psi, just as fermion, which is in these theories, we can actually show emergence of mass and confinement. And this is on R3 cross S1, it's small S1. Small S1. This is something interpolating between this theory and that theory. But this theory does not have fundamental scalars in it. So that's the thing that makes interesting. This is the whole list. Okay, so this is from like 70s, this is 90s, and this is in the early 2000s. Okay, roughly, actually late 2000s, roughly one reasonable solution every 20 years. But they all have features, unlike Yang-Mills or QCD on R4. Okay. Okay, and today's lecture, I will describe this work, beautiful work by Polyakov, Sasha Polyakov from 70s. It is a, if you go to two space-time dimension, just two space-time dimension, one space and one time. Of course, you know that it is relatively easy, one plus one space-time. So space is one dimensional. Then of course, the nature of the Coulomb field changes. So then the, in one dimension, Coulomb field is linear, right? B of R is linear. Actually, and because of that, the confinement sometimes becomes a trivial problem in one plus one dimension. And there are lots of toy models here, lots of toy models. But it's also very, it is fairly unrealistic. I think the closest thing to be a theory that's sufficiently realistic and that exhibits some very interesting features is this Polyakov model. And in both Polyakov model, Seiberg-Witten theory and QCD adjoint, the following things play very prominent roles in on R3, in the stories on R3 and R3 times S1, monopoles are instantons. Okay, so they are really some tunneling events between some perturbative vacua of these quantum field theories. So, and this is the reason we spend so much time in describing instantons in all gory detail in quantum mechanical limits, all these saddle points. So monopoles are instantons. They are really tunneling configurations between perturbative vacua. Remember your double well potential. You know, there were these tunnelings back and forth, and they generated level splitting in the double well potential. You know, and these are these objects, monopoles, and some of their interesting composites play quite prominent role on R3 and R3 cross S1 discussions. There is monopole, and there is a lesser known object called bion. This is relatively much more recent, but this is also magnetically charged. So it has magnetic charge and electric charge. In the Cyber-Quinton story, the important objects on R4, the important objects which are tied up with the confinement, and these things, these objects do not appear in the microscopic Lagrangian of the theory, but they come out as, they still come out in the theory in one way or another. The monopole particles now, monopole particles, not instantons, or monopole or dion particles. So these have magnetic charge, monopole particles, QM, QE, you can call it 1, 0. And for dion, you have both magnetic charge and electric charge. This is not equal to 0, so neither of them is zero, okay? Neither Q magnetic or Q electric is zero. These things play prominent role in confinement and mass gap generation, but I am just saying in words. And now let me go to Polyakov model and describe it. And again, I want to, everybody in their mind should distinguish what a monopole particle is and what a monopole instanton is. So when you say instanton, it is an instant in time. So it is localized both in space and time. Instanton, localized both in space and time. So in a Euclidean description of the space, they are points. But if you have, for example, particles have word lines. So they are not localized in time, x of t, they have word lines. So they are not localized in time. So these are like genuine particles, okay? Now, let me now describe this Polyakov model. Any questions so far? So this is the Lagrangian in the Polyakov models. Okay, we can take this thing in SU2 gauge theory. If you want it, you can take SUN gauge theory, or you can take it in any classical group, the group. It doesn't really matter. Okay, so there is a gauge field, as I promised. There is a scalar, and there is a potential for this scalar. And these are n by n matrices, okay? Now, if you are in SU2, for example, you have this potential P of phi. And for example, in SU2, you can write phi is equal to phi a sigma a, where sigma are Pauli matrices. Yeah, and then this is like P3, phi1 plus I phi2, phi1 minus I phi2, minus phi3. These are fields like that. So you can, for example, for SU2, you can repackage this phi field to a vector phi1, phi2, phi P3, okay, to a vector. And the potential can be this, for example. P square minus V square squared. Some potential like that, okay? Now, this is just, you know, some theory that we that is very tractable in 3 dimension to plus 1 dimension. In Euclidean description, it is 3D, but in Minkowski description, it is 2 plus 1. So both of them are same. You have a potential like that. And if the potential tells you that the minimum is at phi square classical minima, classical min is that phi square is equal to v square, you can always choose this phi to be in the, you know, phi 3 direction. You can assume that phi 3 is v. So in the matrix notation, you, in the vacuum, you can say that in the vacuum, you have this, you know, one reasonable minima is this of the potential, okay? So you have a Higgs field, adjoint Higgs field. This is not fundamental Higgs field. If you had a fundamental Higgs field like we have in nature, it makes everything that couples to it immediately massive. But if you have an adjoint Higgs field, it's a little bit interesting thing. Actually, its interaction with gauge field, d phi, you know, remember it has this term, d phi plus I gauge field phi. So this thing squared, actually, if you put these classical backgrounds, you know, phi is, let's take V minus V. If you look to commutator of A field with this thing, this is in the sigma 3 direction, but A field is again gauge field. I am suppressing the index, okay? A mu A sigma A. So it has components in A3, minus A3, A1 plus IA2, A1 minus IA2, you immediately see that if you have a commutator like that, sigma three component of A commutes with scalar wave. Right, because they are diagonal. Both of them are in sigma 3 direction. But just look at this commutator. But the other components do not. Sigma 1 and sigma 2 do not commute with sigma 3. And you can look at this term, and it will generate a mass term. Let me call this component W plus, and this component W minus. And these are really W bosons, similar to W bosons. You will see that you will generate a mass term, which is V square W plus modulus square. You will generate a mass for off diagonal gluons, let me say gluons. So I will call off diagonal gluons as W bosons, okay? They acquire a mass. But the diagonal component remains massless, gapless. Okay. Now, so it is something, you see, you had a potential here. It was something like that. If you look to minima, it is minima is like S2 worth of minima. So this is really, the minimum is P1 square plus P2 square plus P3 square is actually V square. It's really like a sphere. And you can choose any point. It doesn't matter. This is your vacuum manifold. On your vacuum manifold, you can choose any point. I picked this North Pole point on this vacuum manifold. And in the matrix language, this corresponds to this two by two diagonal matrix, and that's the classical minimum of my potential. Of course, there are quantum fluctuations, but if I insert that classical minimum to here, it tells me that for gauge field, this component and this component acquires mass, and but these diagonal components do not. In the general story for SUN, I will not derive it, I will just write down. You will have these on the diagonal, you will have n minus one fields because there is a constraint, there is tracelessness condition. And on the off diagonal, there should be n square minus one minus n minus one, which is n square minus n field. So there are n square minus n W bosons. And when you do the same procedure, these n minus one, I will call them photons, remain massless. So when is n equal to only one photon remain massless by this adjoint Higgsing. But for the SUN case, n minus one of them remains massless. And here is the striking thing. These n minus one photons, you can never get them out in perturbation theory. If you are considering perturbative vacuum of the theory, you are done with the solution of the theory. You go to long distances, you have n minus one massless photons, and that is the whole story, okay? Gap them out means you can never make them massive. And since we are in 2+1 dimension, now the V of R, if we consider some quark and anti-quark perturbatively, you know, Coulomb potential in three space time dimension is 1/R. Reminder, let's say V of R, 3D. In 3D, you can think of a point, line, surface. The Coulomb potential for this is 1/R. Coulomb potential for this is log R in 3D, okay? And Coulomb potential of this is linear in distance, if the distance, okay, R, okay, in 3D. For a point, line, and surface. We know this from, you know, simple freshman physics, but this thing log R and linear in R, Coulombic potential, also in 2D usual Coulomb is log R. So normally these photons would mediate some Logar type interactions between these quarks. So this theory, to all orders in perturbation theory, it has massless photons, and Coulombic potential, Coulombic, since we are in two dimension, log R potential. Okay. If this was the whole story, I wouldn't make this class, of course. The question is, do the photons remain gapless, non-perturbatively? Does the Coulombic log R potential turn into a linearly confining potential? Okay. also non-perturbatively. These are the questions, okay? Any questions at this stage? At this stage, actually, we solved this theory perturbatively. You are done, okay? By the way, this Polyakov is discussed in multiple good books. One of them is Tom Banks QFT. Tom Banks QFT discusses. Also, almost all condensed matter QFT books, not high energy QFT books, discusses it. You can go, for example, Altland, which is a very good book of Simons, condensed matter QFT, or Fratkin, or Wen, Jiugang Wen. All of these books discusses this theory. Unfortunately, in high energy physics community, you know, for some reason, it is not discussed in standard textbooks, except for Tom Banks's book. And I think it must be part of fairly standard QFT curriculum in at the graduate level. For condensed matter theorists, it is, interestingly. Okay, all of these texts. Oh yes, that's correct. That's correct. Okay. Now the question is this: does the photon ever become massive? Does it acquire a mass? Question two is there a linear confinement? Okay, these are the two questions. Do you have any questions at this stage? From now on, okay, please feel free to interrupt anytime, you know, just come in and ask whatever you want to ask, and I will tell you this story. And you know, there is one more QFT book. It's a very good book, but it is a bit advanced. Of course, there is Polyakov's book, which is unreadable for a good graduate student in general, if he is not very, very good. But there is also a book called QFT for Mathematicians. And there is lectures in that QFT, lectures by Witten. And there's a section on this. These are extremely good lectures, very good. But you have to have some background in quantum field theory to read it. You have to take at least one class or two classes, I don't know, to be able to read it. But if you are, I always thought that, yeah, it can be read, but some people told me that it's very tough. It's very difficult. But this book, QFT for Mathematicians, there are very, it is written by a number of physicists or mathematicians, but the parts, there is a like 15 or 20 chapters on QFT. And the only problems with them is that the texts are written by not Mr. Witten, but probably by some students in the class, and students in the class are outstanding mathematicians. So they change things to a language that is perfect for them. And that is the difficulty, part of the difficulty. I think in general, Witten is quite pedagogical in many respects in his descriptions. But if you can sidestep some things that mathematicians say, you will do fine, okay? But this book at the advanced level is very good, but it is not a standard QFT book, okay? Now, this is the question. Is masslessness stable? smooth of photon stable or is it gapped? Is it ultimately gapped? Here is the interesting story. All of these objects I described here, for example, these W plus minus, these scalars of diagonal component, everything has electric charge because they are written in the Lagrangian in terms of elementary fields, SUM fields. And I told you that the action looked something like this. So the action was like F square plus D phi square. So this was the action. There is also, there is a trace in front, never mind. This F is really F mu nu square, and this is D mu phi square. There is a potential, but the potential actually in Polyakov model compared to the classical action is perturbative. It is okay to make it perturbative. There is no harm there. So when you are considering classical saddles of the system, if this is perturbative, you can just look to the classical saddles coming from classical action. From classical action. And you can pull off this trick I showed you in quantum mechanics. This is like A square plus B square. You can make it A minus B square plus something, you know, 2AB. So you can write this as F, okay. It will be actually star F, let me see. Okay. I am being slightly sloppy here. F here has two index. Phi here has, the derivative with respect to phi has one index. Let me write it in a sloppy notation, but there will be something like this, okay? Or minus and minus m plus f d phi kind of thing, okay? For the action, let me take it to be minus, it doesn't matter. So whenever this thing is equal to zero, so that corresponds to something something called self-dual. Self-dual. So the equation is following: F mu nu epsilon rho mu nu in the index notation d rho phi. So this is a matrix equation. Okay, this is my terrible handwriting, okay. Rho, so in the index free notation, this is like star of F is equal to d phi. These are self-dual equations, and if you set this to, there is a 1 over g square, g3 square up front. These are actually solutions of this, solutions of this are saddles in the problem, and they will correspond to monopoles with magnetic charge. With magnetic charge. You see in this story, there is a left-hand side, which is a gauge field. It includes in particular the magnetic field. And on the right-hand side here, there is a scalar. So there is an interplay between scalars and gauge fields, okay? And so, but let me tell you what is happening, roughly speaking. So I told you that the scalar is something like this. There is a background and there is fluctuations. This is fluctuations, okay? Fluctuations, but this background is due to your classical potential. If you think of the eigenvalues here, one of them was V, the other was minus V, okay? So you can see that actually, let's say this is V, this is minus V, but these things are actually have quantum fluctuations on top of them, okay? And once in a while, they may touch. Once in a while, in some space-time point, okay? But they fluctuate and they touch. They touch when V is roughly zero. But exactly at that point, something interesting happens, because when V around zero, for example, when they touch, remember SU2 here, I didn't say this in words. It's very non-pedagogical of me. We say here at this stage, just a second. We say here at this stage that we started with SU2 gauge field and it is Higgs to U1 and there's a gapless U1. For the SUN, you Higgs it down to U1 to the N minus one. These are your dual photons, okay? So, and the question is about the fate of this remaining U1, whether it is gapped or not, okay? So, but something interesting happens. In this part, SU2 is broken down to U1, but whenever these eigenvalues fluctuate and they touch each other, SU2 actually restores, okay? So you can actually find out the solution to this equation. F mu nu, you know, star F is equal d phi. And the profile for phi of r, some non-trivial solution, are like this. You know, it is asymptotically V, because you know that that is your classical minimum. You must stick there. But once in a while, there is no harm for this thing going to zero and doing this. This is a non-trivial solution. This one, just V, it is perturbative vacuum. But on top of perturbative vacuum, once in a while, you can have a solution like that. And there is a corresponding in Euclidean space, you can view this F mu nu epsilon mu nu rho is the 1/2 magnetic field, B rho, the magnetic field. This profile is actually, you can also sketch the magnetic field associated with it, because if phi changes in this way, that means you are sourcing something like a magnetic field. And asymptotically, you generate a magnetic field which is asymptotically proportional to sigma 3, but it is like 1 over r, r hat. So 1 over r square, I'm sorry, the magnetic fields. Okay, it is like you have a, in three dimension, it is like a, you have magnetic monopole, okay, Q magnetic, and its field, magnetic field is Q magnetic divided by R square, R hat, okay? There is an outgoing magnetic field. So to begin with, in your microscopic theory, there was no electric degrees of freedom, magnetic degrees of freedom. Everything was electric, okay? But now you have these tunneling events, instantons, and I gave a Euclidean description of it, which generates a magnetic field, you know. And here's the crucial point. If we go ahead and take this solution, phi b solution, insert it to the action, these are finite action configurations. Action of the monopole at leading order is 4 pi divided by G3 square times this V. V was, remember, phi, Bev was V minus V. So these are finite action, but what does finite action means? Take R3, think of it this box. Think the R3 as if it is this box. You can compactify it to T3, it doesn't really matter. This exponential of minus S monopole are actually tunneling events in between perturbative vacua of this non-trivial theory, okay? But this quantity is actually literally density of monopoles. If you put the right thing up front to make this thing dimensionally right, it is mw cube, mass of w boson cube times exponential s monopole. So there are these charged particles, the charged instantons here. In the Euclidean point of view, you can really think of this something that you are extremely familiar with. This is a charged plasma, charged Coulomb gas. Coulomb gas. But the only difference from the electric Coulomb gas is that your ingredients are magnetically charged. It's a magnetic Coulomb gas, okay? There are these charged objects here, there. They have a finite density. That means that if you take a box with volume V, the number of these configurations divided by the volume is actually mw cube exponential minus s monopole. So in the Euclidean description of the vacuum state, you say that this is the density of the monopoles, of the instantons in this story. Now, go back to your quantum mechanical story. You know, we had this double well, okay? And we had these, for example, tunnelings from left to right and right to left, I bar. And we had a Euclidean picture, which was this instanton, anti-instanton, instanton, anti-instanton. So there is back and forth tunneling. These are really tunnelings between these two perturbative vacua. You should interpret these instantons as perturbative tunneling between some perturbative vacua of this theory, okay? But in the Hamiltonian language, it is extremely tricky to describe this. I know the description. It is never a textbook material. I briefly mentioned in a paragraph in the Tom Banks's book, but the thing that there are these tunnelings tells you that, you know, the non-perturbative vacuum is very different from perturbative vacuum. Perturbative vacuum was like nothing, you know. In the quantum mechanical example, one of the perturbative vacuum is x is equal minus one, the other is x equal plus one. You know, x equal plus one, x equal minus one. But non-perturbative description of the vacuum is many trips between these two. And this thing tells us that the ground state is unique, for example. The fact that there are tunneling configurations between them tells us that the ground state wave function is neither localized to left nor to right. And the ground state wave function is neither this nor that, rather the ground state wave function is a combination of these two, okay? So these monopole gas if you want to ever think of this system in the Hamiltonian language, it tells you that there are perturbative vacua in the system. And these monopoles are really tunneling events between them, but it is changing the magnetic charge at infinity. Here, instanton goes from minus one to plus one. They have some, or for a particle on a circle, the instanton had winding number, right? And so it has some non-trivial entity associated with it. And here, in our story, the magnetic field, if we have a magnetic field, if we consider on R3, okay, B on R3, let's say local, you know, source from some point, if you take a sphere at infinity, this is nothing but magnetic charge. Maybe there is a, yeah, the magnetic charge by Gauss's law, okay? So these objects, magnetically charged objects, proliferate. Very good. Now,
could I ask a question before move on?
Yes.
Earlier, you said that we get the SU symmetry back at one point.
Yeah.
How do we see that? I mean,
at the core of instanton. Okay, if you write down the solution to this equation, I didn't write down the solution because it's not. Yeah, it is written in a line. Probably I can write it. Okay, the solution of this is actually this picture and that picture. Okay, let me write this in a better language. Magnetic field is equal to dV, okay? And these are matrices, but if you just, this picture is just third component of the magnetic field, for example, or actually we can know, radially we can solve it, you know, the radial profile. So you see that here, when you have a wave here, when you have a Higgs scalar, V minus V, then we have seen that SU2 was broken to U1. But if you go to the core, V becomes zero. You no longer have adjoint Higgsing effects. So this is the reason that at this point you restore SU2 back.
So do we get it at one space point?
Actually, in this picture here, all these tiny cores are points where SU2 partially restores, SU2 restores at the cores. But the point is, this set of points is fairly dilute. It is given by this quantity here. Okay. On the whole space, you know, most part of the space is in the perturbative vacuum, okay? Like in the double well description, you know, when you do this instanton, anti-instanton gas, okay? Actually, most of the time, except, let's say this is your R direction, okay? Except these points, okay, map them here. Except these points, you are always in the vacuum. You are always in the perturbative vacuum. But these points mean everything. Okay, this is in quantum mechanics. Same story in QFT. Here, the space is R3, and there is this discrete set of points where SU2 partially restores. But if you look at any point in the bulk of this thing, of this in this box, if you look to the V field, if you observe it, it will be this V minus V, whatever it is, okay?
This is how the perturbation series give information about non-perturbative calculation.
It is much more difficult in this system. In quantum field theory, remember that in quantum mechanics, I told you that there is a Borel resummation of the perturbation theory, which was twofold ambiguous. And if you look to instanton, anti-instanton, which was twofold ambiguous. And we actually proved this statement in quantum mechanics, okay? In QFT, you can actually show that M bar is twofold ambiguous, okay? But for perturbation theory, you cannot calculate anything beyond few orders, two, three orders, at least analytically. Okay.
So that the procedure doesn't work here.
It doesn't work here naively, but there is good reason to think that now to think that this relation is actually still true. Because of the following, actually. Okay, I said that I will not describe tunneling event in Hamiltonian, but I can just say a word, or should I say a word, or stick with my script. Can we postpone this to the end? I can tell you this, but if let me finish my story today, because you see, I can get scattered in my mind, but let me finish my story first, then I will give what we can do about this story. But it requires...
By the way, it's...
Go ahead.
Sorry, please. I was going to just say, just going to remind the time that it's already 6:15, actually.
Oh, okay. Then we can wrap up quickly.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Okay, then let me finish actually this story. I will not write down too much mathematical formula, but I will tell you something interesting, okay? One thing is, so the vacuum is a magnetic plasma kind of thing, okay? So here is a thing, okay? There are two descriptions here. I am thinking which one is easier. Here is the thing, okay? To this system, let us insert an external magnetic charge. Okay. Q magnetic. Okay. But now I bet that you know Debye effect. If you put Coulomb gas to a Coulomb plasma, Coulomb gas or plasma, if you insert an external charge Q, its field will no longer be Q over R. So the Coulomb gas plasma electric, okay? But it will be Debye screened. So this thing will be modified to Q times exponential minus R divided by L Debye divided by R. If you look to in three dimension, if you look to, let's say 3D, V of R, the potential, if you put an external charge, but if the surrounding medium is a electric plasma, then the field will decay instead of 1/r, it will decay much more quickly, exponentially. Okay, this tells you that the photon actually in this medium becomes massive. So I will wrap up in five. Is that okay, Soner? Can I finish it in 5 minutes? Okay, Soner is not there, so it doesn't. So this becomes massive. So this is like Debye effect in a magnetic medium. If you insert this external magnetic charge, its field will no longer be 1/r², but its field, there will be Debye screening. So this is the this L Debye is inverse of the mass gap. And you can show that it is exponential S monopole divided by 2, okay? The density of the monopoles up to some, let me put the dimensions right, MW minus 1. So because of the proliferation of these monopoles, let me just write this conclusion, then let me wrap up. Proliferation of monopoles, photons become massive. There is another description. You remember that in the normal superconductor, you cannot put a magnetic field inside a superconductor. There is a Meissner effect. It tries to expel it. You know, let's say this is superconductor. Let's say you exert some magnetic fields. It tries to expel it, okay? But if the material is infinite and you try to magnetic fields, insert B field, it squeezes it to some tubes here inside the material. It allows the magnetic field to enter, but energetically it squeezes it to tiny flux tubes, magnetic flux tubes. This is electric superconductor. And you do obtain these flux tubes. In our system, if you insert an electric charge here, Q electric, minus Q electric, actually, you can show that if the field spread out uniformly in the system, it will cost a lot of energy. It will cost, with the system size, it will cost an R square worth of energy because there are magnetically charged objects around, okay? The minimum energy configuration turns out to be this. So you form these flux tubes and this leads to confinement. So I only said this at the very qualitative level. I did not write the formula, but I just want to wrap up. So you show that mass of photon is greater than zero, and it is actually minus MW times exponential minus S monopole divided by two. And also there is a linear confinement at large distances that you can calculate, okay? And the tension is also proportional to S monopole, okay? So this system exhibits both mass gap as well as linear confinement. And both of these effects in this particular case are sourced by non-perturbative saddles in the problem, which are monopole instantons. If you want, let me officially finish here. But I can, if you have questions, feel free to ask. There is one part of the story I sidestepped. Maybe I want to write one more formula. In 2+1 dimension, a photon has how many polarization? Only one. In 3+1, it has one polarization. So you can actually write down a photon as a scalar. Sigma is a scalar. It is sometimes called dual photon. This relation is called, somebody asked this question before, Abelian duality. Then the Maxwell term, F square, Maxwell term is written like this, d sigma square. Now, this thing actually, at the perturbation theory, has a shift symmetry. Sigma plus epsilon has a shift symmetry, perturbation theory, perturbatively. And this shift symmetry tells you that this sigma field, this scalar remains massless to all orders in perturbation theory, okay? You can calculate Noether current of this shift symmetry, and Noether current J, Noether current, is actually d sigma, which is magnetic field. But non-perturbatively, we know that this current non-perturbatively is not conserved, because this is the magnetic charge density. Whenever you have monopoles, this is not conserved. So current violated non-perturbatively and not conserved. Conserved non-perturbatively. And you can show that, this is what Polyakov did. You can show that the Lagrangian becomes d sigma square. I am just writing the important terms, ignoring all the constants. S monopole mw cube cosine sigma. This term is generated from the proliferation of the monopoles and generate this kind of potential for the sigma field. Sigma is 2 pi periodic, okay? And you see that around the minimum here, sigma becomes massive. You can actually take this Lagrangian, and this is actually Lagrangian description of the Coulomb gas. This is same as Coulomb gas. You know, in the Pett integral, if you take this Lagrangian and expand the cosine sigma, and this thing, this object, exponentialized sigma, is not, it's called monopole operator, because monopole operator. And in this language, it is a dual operator, but in the original language, it is difficult to describe. You have to give the field profile. So this generates a monopole at some point zero, for example. And so, and you can actually from this thing, so this is the final result. So this theory, the dual theory is this. This is dual theory, okay? So let me stop here. And if you have questions, let me take them.
Mithat Hocam, thank you so much for this 6 days marathon lecture series.
Oh yeah. Yeah,
it's not awesome, honestly. And
it's
my pleasure.
Thankful. It's my pleasure.
Yeah, I feel like we could go on like for days, but we don't wanna
No, we want to return to normal life, you know, so.
Yeah.
It's correct, right?
Yeah, that's true, but okay. So I guess we can stop the recording, then if there are any questions from the audience, we can switch to an informal chat. Just give me a second.